March 2018 special online talk series. Tonight we are extremely happy, delighted to have Mr. Arnold Chen, the founder and CEO of Teach for Hong Kong. Let's give a big hand first. Before I pass the time to Arnold, I would like to introduce you, who is Arnold. Okay. First of all, I believe most of you, if you are a local student, you may go through this public exam called HKCEC. Arnold, he earned 10 distinctions in Hong Kong Certificate of Education Examination in 2006. That was not his only achievement. He then moved to Chinese University for his BBA degree in Global Business Studies, where I got my bachelor as well. And then he moved to the Harvard Business School for his MBA program. Later on, he worked in the institutional sales in Goldman Sachs, covering Greater China institutional client. At that time, he has this idea to start this NGO to serve primary and secondary school students. He was also the volunteer for Teach4China and helped plan the fundraising strategies. There are lots of things ongoing for Arnold, and we receive many different awards. I would like to pass the time to Arnold to tell us more about his mind, his heart, and his vision. Thank you, Arnold.
Thank you so much for coming for this session at night. I think last time I spoke to that, this kind of audience at night, it will be at bar in University Hall. So thank you so much for coming at night, and I know it's late, so I'll cut this really short, and I appreciate the exchange that I'll have with you guys afterwards. So Dr. Ray just mentioned, so I'm Arnold, I'm a founder of Teach4HK Hong Kong, along with my colleague Evan is here today as well. So what do we do? I'm going to explain a little bit about Teach4HK Hong Kong as well. But a little bit background of why I started this educational nonprofit is that I'm sure, like, if you guys are from Hong Kong, like, almost all of you would have heard complaints about Hong Kong's education system. But interestingly, we actually rank quite high in all those like national like education kind of like ranking in terms of PISA scores, in terms of other kind of like relatively ranking. So while the whole society is complaining about education, do we really know what's the root cause of the problem? Do we know what's the root solution to the problem? And back then, when I was still working in finance, I graduated my first job from BBA and worked in finance for a couple of years. I did a lot of volunteering on weekends, like weekend tutorials, helping kids to learn English. But every year, the same class of kids will come again, and then they will have the same issue, they will have the same lack of exposure. We teach them for an afternoon, and then they will go back to the same very boring classroom, very boring examination system. So a lot of my colleagues might feel very good that, oh, I've taught a kid for like half a day, and I've done my voluntary service. But have I done any change, or have I really kind of improved the kid's life or improved Hong Kong's education system? To me, the answer was no. And I then believed that being born and raised in Hong Kong, like, I felt deeply kind of indebted to the city's education system. And I felt like I had a lot of opportunities, not because I'm smart, not because I'm more hardworking, it's just because I'm lucky. I'm lucky that my skill set matches with what the system tested on. And I have a lot of friends who are extremely smart, who are extremely brilliant. Unfortunately, their skill set is not being captured by the system. And to me, if we want to change Hong Kong's education, if we want to help Hong Kong's education, we need more than just weekend tutorials. We need more than just weekend volunteering. We need a model that can really kind of change the landscape in the long run. And before I actually went on to the States to do my MBA, I actually worked in a nonprofit called Teach4China. Have anyone heard of Teach4America? No, right? So what they do basically is that they pull like very, very bright and passionate young graduates from college and to teach in underprivileged neighborhoods for a period of 1 year or 2 years. And at the same time, with the hope that they can help the kids, but at the same time, hopefully, these young graduates, they will really understand what the kids are going through. And after the year service or 2 years of service, they can go on to become long-term leaders. No matter they're going to become lawyers, they're going to become doctors, or they're going to become government officials. Because they have served these kids for so long, they themselves will become change makers for these kids in various sectors. And that's why I'm hugely impressed by the model. And 3 years back, I actually brought the model in Hong Kong. And now let's teach you Hong Kong. I can go through a little bit about Teach Hong Kong, and I'm going to show you a little bit video of how the 2 year, or the 3 year that we have of our fellowship have kind of achieved an impact. So, like I said, despite the fact that we have a very sound education system, we do see a lot of inequality in education. Like a kid from an underprivileged family is 5 times less likely than a kid from a well-off family to get into uni. And I'm sure most of you who are uni students know, like, getting a uni degree in Hong Kong is kind of important in terms of like escaping the poverty trap. And to us, education inequality in Hong Kong is still something that we care deeply about. And at the same time, when so many people complain about education, do we really understand what teachers are facing in Hong Kong? How much burden we are putting on the frontline teachers working alone? How can we attract better talent to help change the landscape? So this is a problem we face. And that is why Teach4HK, we want to be a growing movement, that we want to recruit young graduates that could provide quality and holistic education in these underprivileged schools through a 1 year full-time teaching fellowship. At the same time, after the year, they could go on to become servant leaders, long-term leaders, that can drive change in various sectors for our kids, for our education. Our model is very simple. So basically, we recruit from all the big unis in Hong Kong. We recruit not only from education majors. In fact, none of our fellows, teaching fellows, are from education background. We take in students from law degree, from business degree, from engineering degree, and then we train them for 6 weeks with faculty partnerships, and then place them in a 10-month teaching fellowship in underprivileged primary and secondary school. All the schools that we work with in Hong Kong have at least 50% of their students coming from government subsidized background, meaning they're getting CSSA, as a government assistance, or any kind of assistance that prove their family is actually under poverty line. And then we have that 10 months where our fellows will actually have full accountability in the classrooms, meaning that they will actually teach like a normal teacher, have full leadership and accountability of how they impact each and every student's achievement. And after that, we actually have a lot of employer partnerships like Big Four accounting firms, a lot of large developers, you know, where we will have fast-track interview opportunities for our fellows to go on to become high successful careers in various sectors. Because we know in Hong Kong, education is interrelated to what we see in the society. If we want to change education, we want people in the society to really understand education and change education for good. So this is basically our vision and theory of change. In the short run, hopefully, by providing better in-class teaching, better extracurriculars, and better life and career education, that we really enrich the exposures of these underprivileged students, increase their learning motivation, and hopefully lift them up from the poverty gap. At the same time, we want these young future leaders to become a strong alumni network that could be a growing movement of leaders that drive long-term systemic change in Hong Kong's education. So how are we unique and different from other educational nonprofits in Hong Kong? We are a full-time, four-year service program. We're not a weekend tutorial. We're not a monthly one-to-one tutorial versus other nonprofit. We require our fellows to dedicate full year with full accountability of students' learning. Because we believe for many of the kids that we are serving, they're either from broken families or they're either from ethnic minority families that really need teachers to put in extra care to help lift their motivation and help solve the problems that they're facing in life. And at the same time, we are having all our young graduates to reimagine what teaching or what a teacher is about. Like most of the fellows that we have chosen, and from our very, very short application pool, without Teach4HK, they were never thought about being a teacher. But because of Teach Hong Kong, they can dedicate themselves 1 year full-time, just like again, we're going to serve our kids in Hong Kong. And then a lot of great feedback from our principal are saying that because our fellows are from various backgrounds, like I have civil engineers teaching STEM education in underprivileged primary school, I have law degree graduates who teach English in underprivileged primary school. These diverse backgrounds actually are very useful for our underprivileged schools because these provide very diverse perspectives to the kids that we're serving, which we see face a huge gap in terms of exposure. For instance, we have kids who are studying in places like Tiananmen. Like at the age of 15, 16, we want to bring them out to see the world, we want to bring them to like do corporate business. And they would tell me, hey Arnold, where's Causeway Bay? I don't even know where Causeway Bay is. But these are the kids who are at the age of 13 or 16. And these are the kids are from the schools that might have zero university admission rate. That means he might finish high school without enough grades, without the grades going to uni. With such a huge lack of understanding of what's going on in the world, how can they survive and how can they really make a meaningful living in a very competitive society like Hong Kong? Another thing that we see we're different is that we are change into empowerment of profit. Not only are our students our beneficiaries, the graduates, the young fellows that went through our program are also our beneficiaries, which we believe we're actually empowering the young graduates to become long-term change makers that could really drive systemic change in Hong Kong's education. So like I said, we are a movement of young people, but at the same time, we are a movement that includes a lot of our partners that are corporates and other nonprofits that we believe if we want to drive change in education, we need a lot of collaboration as well. So in the past 3 years, I started teaching Hong Kong. We started really, really small. When we first started 3 years ago, we only had 6 fellows in 3 different primary schools. Right now, we have expanded our size 2 times in 2 years, where we have 24 fellows, full-time fellows, serving in 12 partner schools, serving close to 10,000 underprivileged students. So we also did a lot of social impact analysis in terms of measuring our impact, because we are a nonprofit where we have a lot of donors that support our work, and we actually commission a lot of professors to really measure how our fellows can actually increase our students' learning and benefit the students. So basically, this is what we achieved in the last 3 years. We are a very, very young and nonprofit. My whole team, except myself, is under the age of 25. We are a group of young people, but at the same time, we're quite lucky in the past couple years. We have actually received quite a lot of media coverages, and at the same time, we have received quite a lot of support from various stakeholders, various advisors, such as Dr. Ray, to help drive our movement forward. And Teach4HK is always about a movement of young people, a movement of young people that are willing to dedicate their career for at least a year to serve the neighborhood, to serve society. And in the long run, that they could become long-term leaders that will drive change in education. So before I want to open the floor to Q&A, I want to show you a video of this year's fellowship opening ceremony. So it will conclude our first 2 years of fellowship, which have a lot of feedback from our stakeholders, including our students, and including our partners, principals, and including our fellows. It's going to be in Chinese, but we do have English subtitles.
Thank you.
The brightest and the most passionate young people of the society. and send them to the most underprivileged neighborhoods, no matter it's rural areas in China, or the less developed areas in the States, or the underprivileged schools in Hong Kong. And you have them serve for a long period of time, and believing that these young people would really care about students and would really care about how to change education for life. And I think that mission is universal, no matter it's Hong Kong or the States or in China. But Hong Kong is a little bit different. We do not have rural areas in Hong Kong, but we do have a lot of areas in Hong Kong that are underprivileged. And I'm sure some of you guys might be economic majors. You guys might know that among all the developed economy, Hong Kong actually has the highest Gini coefficient. That means we have the highest wealth gap between the wealth, the richest and the poor. As a young people in Hong Kong, we went through the Hong Kong education system. We were given a lot of resources. What is our role to play to close the wealth gap, to contribute to Hong Kong? So in Teach for America, it's called Teach for America. It's because joining Teach for America, teaching in these underprivileged schools, it's like joining the army. It's like building your country in the classroom. And for us, as young people in Hong Kong, are we entitled? Do we always feel that we're entitled? Do we always feel that the society owes us? Do we owe our society as well? I think the answer is yes. How can we contribute to the society instead of just paying tax? Can we really help the society by changing our next generation, by dedicating yourself to serving underprivileged? I think the answer is yes.
Right. Anyone want to raise a question?
Yes, Monisha first, and then you next, and then you first.
Hi, my name is Monisha. So I wanted to ask you a question about how in Hong Kong there's a very competitive atmosphere where all the fresh graduates, as soon as they leave university, they're very keen to find a very high-paying job, to get the best kind of salary to pay for the incredibly high rent that's here in Hong Kong. So do you find it hard to recruit fresh graduates to take part in your program because you have to take like a year off to go around teaching in schools? So what has been your experience with recruiting graduates?
Recruiting the most passionate and the brightest students is always our biggest bottleneck of growth. Like we have expanded twice in the last 2 years. We want to expand more. We have the funding, we have the resources, we have the team to expand more. But the only thing we lack is recruitment. Because we're recruiting people who are leaders themselves, who are standing in front of a bunch of underprivileged kids who might, at the age of 15 or 16, who couldn't really even recognize the support like people, and who need these young fellows to be effective on day one. That means our selection process is very, very stringent. In the past 3 years, we have selected 41 fellows out of 400 plus applications. And getting the brightest and most passionate people are very, very difficult for us. And that is why we want to emphasize that this program is not just about serving. But the fellows themselves also are the beneficiaries of the program. We want them to see that this year is a good leadership training. Because in Teach for Hong Kong's belief, a good teacher is a good leader. Imagine, like if a fellow can really inspire those underprivileged kids, and make sure that individual kids can learn better. These are good business skills when you go negotiate as a business manager. These are good managerial skills, just like the guy you've seen in the video. These are good leadership skills that will make you better in your career. And that's why we want fellows to see this as a leadership development program. And at the same time, we work with a lot of corporates, like some of the big four accounting firms, some of the like large-scale property developers in Hong Kong, to really say, hey, we have these group of young people who really have the heart to serve, and at the same time who are really good and who really have the leadership potential. And because of that year of education, can you guys give them a chance? And that's why we have these partnerships with these large corporates that will give them fast track into the opportunities right after our fellowship program for them to gain the upper hand in their management training applications. And that helps a little bit, but at the same time, I think when we recruit and when we promote our program, we tend to draw a lot of really, really bright young graduates and who really demonstrate themselves during that year. And I think after that they have proved themselves during a fellowship, it's easy for them to get a job. It's easy for them to go back to banking. It's easy for them to go on to become teachers because If they can make it through teaching in an underprivileged and to mentoring school, there's nothing else they can't do.
Yes, second question.
First of all, I want to congratulate you because this work is amazing and you're doing a great job. And I have two questions. The first one is, what do you see, what's the difference between the professors usually kids have and the people that you are training? Because I guess there's a difference on that one is working. The second question is related to participation. So oftentimes here, I realize local students also from the mainland, they don't like to talk at all. And in many like contemporary educational models, you're supposed to have more interaction. So maybe you have more cordial, more insight on why this is happening, what can we do to overcome
it? I think I can combine that two questions to answer because to me, I think almost education system, it's to the most kind of like the fastest way, it's only designed for 18% of people who can go into uni. This system is not designed for everyone, especially those who can't have enough, who don't have enough grades to get uni. And normal teachers or traditional teachers are using the traditional model to make sure that our kids get enough grades to be that 18%. But at the end of the day, there are still 82% of kids who can't go into uni, who are being kind of like defined as a failure in the system, which in fact, if we are educated, we shouldn't think they are failure. And that's why we need to recruit young, passionate fellows who have strong passion for kids. Our fellows teach in a very, very different way compared to normal teachers. We talk a lot about innovations during their summer training. And at the same time, because these kids, these fellows are not like traditionally trained, they use a lot of different ways to care about students. They use a lot of different ways to like teach students. For example, like a lot of my fellows actually use like new pedagogy, such as flipping classroom, you guys have heard of that, to really inspire those underprivileged kids. At the same time, it's not just, we're not only sending two fellows per school, but we're sending a lot of resources to these schools where our fellows are kind of like a contact point. For example, one of our programs is called English Rockers, where we actually partner with a multinational finance firm in Central. And and our fellow would actually take three to five students every 2 weeks to go to Central and talk to these expat staff. And most of the kids that we work with, they have never talked to a foreigner in their entire lives. They might be 16 or 17. There's only one native English teacher in their entire school, facing 600 students. They might not have seen a foreigner in their life. And to them, learning English grammars is as difficult as memorizing a chemical formula. But going to these like outings, talking to expat in through our programs, they really know, okay, they want to talk about MBA with others. They want to talk about traveling with others. They understand English as a primary means of communication. They don't see English as purely ABC anymore. It's a way of them to express themselves. And by that, we actually help increase their learning motivation for English and to actually widen their world a little bit. Because like I said, like we have a lot of cases where our fellow try to take these students out to understand about the community, understand about the neighborhood. These kids will be frightened to be in another area of Hong Kong because they've never been. Because most of these kids are from single parent family or from parents who live in the public aspect, they don't have the resources or the time to take these kids out. And I think for me, after 3 years of teaching in Hong Kong, I think the biggest gap in terms of Hong Kong's education is the exposure gap. Without the exposure, like say a very interesting example, like I said, we have a kid at 15 or 16 who doesn't know where Oxford Gate is. Versus if you go to all the like prestigious local mainland schools on Hong Kong Island, they will have their entire four-month class go to Australia for exchange. How ironic is that? It's the same Hong Kong, but we have that kind of exposure and that kind of difference. How can we really provide a level playing ground for those kids in those schools that we're serving?